We extend a very warm welcome to all our viewers who are watching us on this show today. I, on behalf of EMRC Indore, welcome all our viewers to this wonderful show which we shall be hosting for you. Technology has touched every aspect of our life, whether it is communication, transportation, trade and commerce, banking and finance, and even education. Education particularly has also come a long way from the days of Gurukul. In the olden days, under the tree tops, under the tree shades, a guru used to impart various types of learnings to the students, the disciples. He used to forego everything and come down to the ashrams of the gurus and stay there as long as they thought they had not acquired a particular type of learning, a particular level of expertise, and that was decided by the guru. In return, the shishyas used to give guru dakshina. From those days, it is really revolutionary to see that now the disciples do not come to the guru, but the guru goes to the disciples, and not only through classroom teaching, but also through various high-tech processes, which includes EduSat, that is educational satellite. This brings us to the concept of e-learning. And to talk on various aspects of e-learning, today we have in our studio a very eminent personality in Dr. Manoj Killedar. We welcome you to this show, sir. For our viewers, Dr. Manoj Killedar is at present the director of School of Architecture, Science and Technology, Yashwant Rao Chauhan, Maharashtra Open University. Dr. Killedar was awarded a PhD in e-learning in 2009. And earlier to that, Dr. Killedar did his M.Tech from IIT Mumbai. Dr. Killedar has had a very vast and checkered experience for the last 25 years. So what better personality than him to talk to all of us about e-learning? To start off our discussion today, sir, I would like to ask a very basic question with which I think it would be appropriate to kick off this particular discussion. What exactly is e-learning?
E-learning is basically learning with the help of web, in short. And learning normally happens in the classroom, face-to-face mode, in front of the teacher. But here, teacher himself reaches to the student's doorstep using internet or web. And then he carry out all the teaching learning processes in a virtual dimension. And after going through this learning experience, student can achieve the same level of knowledge, expertise and skills using various technologies available with the help of internet. In short, learning with the help of internet or web is called e-learning.
Okay, so whenever we talk about e-learning, we are talking about learning with the help of the net or the web.
Yeah.
But that brings us to a very moot and very basic question.
Yeah.
What is the need for this e-learning? Why? Why should we go for e-learning? Why should a student go for e-learning when there are other modes of education available?
It's a very good question and fundamental also. The fundamental reason why there is a necessity for the e-learning have the three dimensions. Any education system of the world wants to maximize the access to the number of students they are imparting education. They are also worried about the quality of education they are imparting. And every education system wants to do it and achieve this better access, better quality at a minimum possible cost. Unfortunately, our face-to-face mode, a conventional mode of education, cannot optimize all the three parameters all at the same time.
Which are these three parameters?
Access, quality, and cost.
Okay.
You think of any situation, for example, in a conventional classroom, you increase the number of students to increase the access. You can reduce the cost definitely because number of students are more in single
class. So economies of scale will be applicable.
But then everyone will accuse you for lowering the quality. because there will be lesser and inferior quality of interactions which are vital for the effective learning.
So the larger the mass, the more inferior the quality of teaching would be.
Yeah,
or the imparting,
it's a natural outcome of the conventional teaching learning process.
Okay.
While e-learning or this web technology enables us to optimize all the three parameters all at the same time, that is one. Then second important reason is that there are billions of the students in the whole world, and approximately 8% could reach from first standard to the higher education. Only 8% student out of 100, only 8 student can reach to the higher education imparted by the university system.
These statistics pertain to only the Indian system?
I am talking, these statistics I am talking about India.
Indian system, okay.
But overall world population statistics is also not very much different.
All right.
It might be a marginal percentage here and there.
But more or less it is.
It is more or less similar. Now, this means that many higher number of percentage of the student are not getting enough education. They are not able to get the proper and enough education to build the required knowledge and expertise, and we need to improve the access. When we are improving the access, we are still want to retain the quality, and we want to do all both of these two things while retaining the cost, minimizing the cost. And the only solution is e-learning, because that is the technology enabled education can do this for us.
So that is why the importance of e-learning is there.
Yeah.
Before we move on further, sir, I would like to ask one simple question. We talked about access, quality and cost.
Yeah.
And you very appropriately gave the example that the more number of students would mean the lesser quality and more inferior quality of teaching, because individual attention is not possible. But at the same time, talking about e-learning, does it not require a lot of very high setup cost? Because when we are talking about e-learning, we are talking about setting up very high-tech infrastructure also, isn't it?
Answer to this question is yes as well as no.
Okay, would you elaborate on that?
It depends on which approach of e-learning you are going to adopt. For example, there is a remote classroom approach.
Okay, so there are two, more than one approach?
Yeah.
Okay, can we know about these approaches a little bit more?
Yeah. Remote classroom approach basically try to imitate a regular face-to-face mode classroom in a virtual dimension.
So it is almost a replica of the face-to-face
classroom? It's a replica, not almost, it's almost 100% replica of the normal classroom in a virtual dimension.
All right.
Where teacher delivers the lecture, it reaches to all students across the globe at the same time, synchronously.
Real-time.
Real-time reaching. Then student can ask the question. Teacher can give replies to the student queries, and every interaction is visible to all others.
So it is actually a live program?
It's a live program.
Fine.
Now, if you take this remote classroom approach, it's a kind of a non-intuitive transformation of the normal classroom into the virtual classroom. It's highly teacher-centric. Teacher has to be in the classroom to get student taught.
Naturally.
Otherwise, it is not possible. So, unless student matches the schedule and place for learning, he cannot learn. It is decided by the teacher when he is going to deliver what.
Right.
It's very effective. It is time-proven technique, no doubt about it, but then extremely costly. The question which you was raising.
Right.
So if you take this approach of remote classroom,
it is quite costly.
Then it is extremely costly and practically not reachable in India for the
masses.
For the masses, where our 90% or more population is.
Right.
Actually, for India, we have to take the another approach, which is equally effective
and less costly.
And very cost effective.
Okay.
It is creating the good learning environment. I will explain you this concept in a very short span of time. A good learning environment is, I will give an example of Indian Institute of Technology. Students perform far better when they are learning in IIT It is not only because they are having the excellent infrastructure, it is also not only because they have got the excellent human resource and they have got the best professors, but the more important reason for this excellence is their learning environment, where student naturally feels that he has to acquire more knowledge, his urge to explore more knowledge is automatically enhanced in that atmosphere, that environment. And this atmosphere itself is a stimulus for his learning efforts. Now, there is a technological name for this approach. It is called social constructivist pedagogy or approach for learning. It means that learner construct the meaning of the new concepts or create the knowledge for himself by interacting with the environment around him.
And this environment is built up by various factors?
Yeah. And this environment consists of, for example, independent learning activities like lectures, interactive learning activities like queries and answers or quiz attempt and so on and so forth.
But these are taking place between the teacher and the student generally, isn't it?
Yeah.
Okay.
Now, in a good learning environment, it is created in the virtual dimension in e-learning, and it is highly student centric, means it does not require teacher to be present at a time when student want to learn. Teacher can deliver the lecture.
So, it is like giving the option to the student to acquire the learning at a time convenient to the student.
Exactly. Means, for example, teacher have delivered the lecture in a live mode.
Right.
Student, for some personal reason, he couldn't attend
the
class
lecture.
Or attend that be present during that class.
So, they should not be deprived from that lecture.
So, that lecture is stored in a digital format on the servers.
Right.
And then he can retrieve it any time afterwards also. Now, for example, he can't ask the question in a real time, but then he can ask the question through the discussion forum. And then same teacher can reply the same query on the discussion forum in an asynchronous mode.
So, means, but there would be a time lag in between the discussion taking place and the answers
coming
in?
Yeah, that is the key. That time lag is essential for two reasons. It makes the system student centric,
right,
that is one.
Right.
And then it provides the time required for the critical reflection.
Absolutely.
Which is required
Absolutely.
For every human being.
Absolutely. Because when the teacher is responding instantaneously, then probably the reaction would be just to satisfy a particular question there and then.
Yeah.
But whereas if the teacher is given time to reflect on that and come up with a more deliberate answer, I think that answer would have much more superior quality than that which was given at the spur of the moment.
It is 100% true. And secondly, it is required for every human being, however talented he may be.
Yes.
Only that time duration might be less for the more clever students, and it might be more for the less clever student. But this time is essential. And in a synchronous mode, when teacher and student are sitting across each other in the classroom, this time available for this critical reflection is very minimal.
Okay.
And normally not enough for the majority of the average students.
Right.
While in this good learning environment approach, where that time factor is eliminated, then student can learn effectively at the pace and the place and time of his choice.
Right.
So, all the three factors, pace, time and place, can be decided by the students and not by the teachers.
But I am just asking a very apparently a very layman's question. But what you are telling me, or telling us rather, it indirectly means that the lot of pressure is taken out from the student's mind, because they are at ease to decide the time, the place and the speed at which they want to learn.
That's right.
But whereas the general impression is that a student at IIT is under a lot of pressure all the time, because they have to excel, they have to do well. The very fact that they are into IIT or any such institution shows that they are very good. So, they have to continue doing so good, and that brings a lot of pressure. So, does that this e-learning, does it ease off certain pressure, and does it help the student in that student friendly environment we were talking about, socialistic constructive environment?
There are two aspects to this. Pressure is good also, because it brings the urge to excel.
Right.
And pressure is bad also, because it removes the flexibility.
How is that?
For example, if you have to complete that thing
within a
scheduled time frame, naturally the pressure comes. You can't perform as well as you can.
Right.
Or you will like to. While in this particular case, you are given a freedom how to learn, when to learn, from where to learn.
Okay.
So you can really achieve the level where you want to achieve that knowledge level and understanding. And I believe learning is far more deeper even for the normal average student when he goes through this process rather than the normal process.
Okay.
And anything which is good is deeper learning, not just
superficial,
not just a rat race where everybody is fighting against each other and trying to excel and getting at number one position. More important from than that is to acquire the knowledge which is having the deep roots, a clear understanding,
yes,
and ability to apply to the unknown situations.
Right, right. So you have come a very long way from 1984 to 2010, and you must have seen a lot of changes in the ways in which learning has been carried on. But there is one thing which I would like to ask you. When talking about teaching, we are basically talking about communicating.
Mm-hmm.
And in case of communications, we also talk about certain types of barriers which hinder or create obstruction in the communication.
That's right.
When we are talking about interpersonal communication, that is a teacher and the student, no other medium in between, the possibilities of various types of barriers or noise is reduced. But in case of e-learning, there has to be a certain type of barrier between the teacher and the student, which is by the very nature of e-learning, certain implements, certain equipment, certain software, hardware are involved. Does this mean that there would be certain noise which create some problem in the communication and which ultimately may distort the very communication which a teacher is trying to establish between the student and the teacher?
I will say noise is a part of every communication.
Absolutely.
Whether it is face-to-face mode or whether it is an e-learning mode. And it has been a very hot topic for the research from recent past, how to reduce this to the minimum and improve the communication effectiveness for the benefit of the students.
Right.
But then noise is not that it is not present in a conventional system, it is there
it
also.
Is there.
It is here also. Only the kind of the noise is different. Here the noise is created by the technologies,
what we
a
term
kind
as
of
mechanical.
The fear and phobia among the learners against technology. Those kind of the noises are prominent.
Right.
While in the regular classroom, noise is of the self-esteem, what others will feel if I ask the stupid question, which is absent here. So what I'm trying to emphasize is the nature of the noise is shifting, but noise will be there.
Will be there.
Now, it is a matter of research, how to reduce it to the minimum and improve the quality.
Okay. So, we are working on that.
Yeah.
Okay. After having talked about the various approaches that you just told us, can we have a look at what are the advantages of e-learning? I mean, of course, you have already mentioned quite a few of them while we have been discussing, but anything else that comes to your mind that is…
Basically, there are many advantages. I will list one by one.
Sure.
The first one is the flexibility of a time and place of learning and teaching. Then second, it is very quick and cost effective. Research all over the world have proved that learning with the help of e-learning strategies is 3 times faster or better. And the cost implications are 3 times lesser. That is the finding. And Don Morrison, in his famous book about e-learning, have confirmed these facts. Then it is probable for the e-learning to use all types of the media in a same universal media of web, internet.
Right. So the print media.
The only requirement is it has to be a digital media and must be deliverable through the web, which in today's reality, every possible communication mode is possible to be digitized and delivered on the web.
What we are talking about is convergence.
Yeah. Okay. Like you can deliver the pictures, you can deliver the audio, you can deliver the video, you can deliver the even virtual classroom where the whiteboard and actual teaching learning interactions are also transmitted across the web
as
in a real time.
Right.
So it is possible to use asynchronous as well as synchronous media. Then because it can use asynchronous media, it is suitable for both type of the students, low as well as high achiever student. If it is a low achiever student, it provides the higher critical time for the reflection. If he is a high achiever student, he is allowed to reflect fast and consume less time for the critical reflection.
Right.
So the system is adopting itself for the intellectual capability of the students.
This is wonderful, because sometimes what happens is there is a mixed classroom and some people may find something very boring, but some for some others it is very basic.
I believe it is not sometime, it is always.
Always.
No class you will find that everyone is at the highest level. Even in IIT.
It is always a mix.
Even in IIT, where the top 2% students are picked up all from all the India.
Even there
is a variation in the intellectual capability of the students. And this exists. It's a universal phenomenon. In all classroom, it is there. Now, as regards to the quality, as I have stated, the quality is enhanced in an e-learning mode by the factor of 3. It, in addition to this enhanced quality, it can maintain same consistent quality across the time or across the geographic location. For example, I will give the example, even the lecture by the same teacher on the same topic,
there can be variations
from the different academic years. There will be definite Absolutely. Difference between the academic quality of the delivery.
Certainly.
But if the quality of lecture is brought to certain level and delivered through e-learning mode, it will be of the same consistent quality.
Yeah, absolutely.
Now, it better matches with the individual learning style. No two students are alike. Every student got its own learning style. For example, somebody wants to learn in an exploratory style where he try to explore on himself rather than getting fed by the teacher.
So instead of spoon feeding, they would like to do it on their own.
Exactly. And some students want everything to be fed. They are not comfortable if they are left alone for exploration. Now, these two extremes of the students, both can be simultaneously served by this approach.
Right.
And with a satisfaction to both of them.
So this is universally applicable to all types of students.
All types of the students.
And everybody would stand to gain.
Yeah. And because it promotes the exploratory style of the learning, then there is one additional outcome of it. It gives the joy of learning, which very few students nowadays are experiencing. Most of them take it as a punishment because they never experience this joy of learning. I personally feel if our education system can enable student to experience this joy of learning, it is the turning point in the history. Because the student need not be pushed to study, they will naturally study all the subject and explore more and better knowledge.
So they wouldn't have to be cajoled into studying or pressurized into studying, they'll do it on their own.
Yeah. And another very important advantage of the e-learning is that all the teaching learning interaction in the e-learning mode are preserved in a digital form. They are reusable from time to time and they are available just on the click. Nothing is lost. So for example, in a classroom, when teacher delivers the lecture and after 50 minutes it comes to end, it is no more in the existence. It is zero. While here it is permanently there, student can access it whenever they want it, and it's a big advantage. I believe I listed all major advantages of the e-learning.
Absolutely. And I think to conclude today's discussion, I would like to ask you one more question pertaining to in the Indian context, sir.
Mm-hmm.
How would e-learning help in shaping the future of the Indian education system? And along with that, sir, if it would be very nice if you can also respond to a question that in a country which is full of population, which is living at very, very low level of income, is this really a way which we can adopt and which can help us in attaining a certain amount, a certain level of knowledge and expertise as far as the international standards are concerned?
I believe this is the only way for building a better, more responsive, more open learning communities of future India. The reason is that from ages we are teaching, we are from ages students are learning. We are using chalk and blackboard from time known to us. But now time have come when we are started realizing that our conventional infrastructure is just not enough to cater more than 8% of the population who wants to learn. And in a democratic country like India, I believe it is a crime to stop remaining 92% population to learn. It is a duty of our democratic system to make the opportunity available to this remaining 92% without compromising the quality while maintaining the same world-class standards of education. And e-learning is the only solution
to do this.
No other methodology known to by any proper scientific research can do this for to achieve this target. And I believe Indian context, there are certain problems like the acute power shortage and technophobia, a low income group students. But then these issues can be tackled by the appropriate suitable strategies. Everything need not be expensive, everything need not be acquired by the student. It can be made available at the community center point of view,
right,
by the government or by the colleges. I personally feel the best knowledge resource of the nation, normally who are concentrated in a very few elite institutions, their knowledge can be digitized and stored in this format and then made available to every other population also, so that they become a real sense national resource.
So sort of a data bank can be built up?
The repository of the learning objects, where student can choose the learning objects, build their own courses, what they want to learn.
And that awareness that this is available has also to be
made
known to them.
And this is the proper way to utilize this very scarce commodity or resource of the nation, that is the intellectual capability. I believe this is the only answer, and our government should look very seriously about this issue and implementing at a national level with a national level of policy and support backup.
Right. Thank you, sir. I think our viewers must have had a very wonderful time with Dr. Killada today, and he has made a few points which are very, very important. One of them, of course, is extending the reach of education to many persons, and to do that, this particular exercise of e-learning will be very helpful. He has talked about only 8% being 8% people getting access to education, higher education, which has to really go much beyond that. And recently we have talked about financial inclusion, taking the basic banking to villages and other remote areas, because 80% people are deprived. Extending that to education, I think educational inclusion is required even much more, because 92% people are deprived from basic education. So I think for that, of course, you have said that the government has a responsibility. I would go a little further and say that even citizens who are well-to-do, who are affluent, and who have acquired a lot of social and economic wealth by staying in this country, they also have a responsibility to all those who are deprived, those who do not have it. And in US and in other European countries, we have this system that people who have made their mark and achieved a particular level economically, financially, socially, they donate a lot of money to those who do not have it. That particular culture is yet to come into India, although we have lots and lots of billionaires and millionaires in our country. So I think it would not really be bad if they start charity. They say it always begins at home. So why not start funding some such noble projects which would bring education to the masses, to the poor, and we have tremendous intellectual capital that can be made use of in our country, and the brain drain which we experience and crib all the time can be prevented. So thank you, sir, for being with us. Thank you for this wonderful and enlightening talk that you have given. And to all our viewers who have been with us, we extend a very hearty thanks to all of you.
Thank you.